पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। नाउ टुडे वी हैव ए न्यू एंड वेरी फैसिनेटिंग टॉपिक, व्हाट इज द पर्पस ऑफ ह्यूमन लाइफ, व्हाई हैव वी कम इनटू दिस वर्ल्ड। आई थिंक दिस इज going to be very interesting subject. So let us move from here onwards. First of all, every one of us, sometime or the other, must have thought, what is this universe? This huge entity with billions of galaxies and trillions of stars. How it came into existence, who made this, how it is run. Look at the precision. None of the trillions of the stars collide against each other. Even if we take our own solar system, the sun rises precisely on time, moves precisely as per the determined path, the seasons come on time, the phases of the moon keep, you know, changing precisely as they are supposed to. The rain comes when it's supposed to come. Even if there's a slight deviation by a few days, you know, there's a tremendous suffering among people. So when we look at this vast entity, this universe, this thought does come to our minds once a while at least, that who made this? But the question is, when we say who made it, then the question arises that if somebody made it, who made the one who made it? You know, somebody says, okay, Paramatma made it. Then the question arises, Paramatma ko kisne banaya? Who made Paramatma? And then this question keeps going backward. It can go backward infinitely. There's no end to that. So this is one thing which we always consider, and if not consider, at least this thought comes to our mind, why it comes, from where it comes, we will look into that. Then there are millions of different species of life. First of all, how life came into being, you know, we don't know how the so-called consciousness came into being, that we became alive and we become dead. And then there are thousands of species of life. As per our ancient writings, the 84 lakh, that is 8.4 million species of life. In the past, the science did not believe it. They thought there are only few thousand species of life. But now they have discovered, and they are coming closer to that figure. They already acknowledge that there are more than 6 million species of life. So they are slowly coming close to that figure of 8.4 million. So how these species came? And look at the difference. There's a small little ant, and there's a fly, and there's a big elephant, and there's a human being. Everybody has a different body structure. Everybody has a different, you know, way of life, completely different way of life. Some living beings don't have that developed thought process, while the humans have developed thought process. Now, as we discussed once earlier, the consciousness has gradations. It goes up. It starts from what we call mineral regime, that is the regime which has lowest level of consciousness, which is like stones and minerals. They have consciousness, but very, very little. And then it goes up to what we call plant regime. Plants have higher level of consciousness. It can grow, it gives leaves and it gives fruits. And then you have animal consciousness. Animals can walk, and perhaps they can even talk among themselves. They move, there's a movement there. and then the human consciousness. Now, human being is the most privileged in this process. We are the only one who can think about this universe. What is this universe? This privilege has been given only to human life. No other life has this privilege. The other life's privilege are basically they feel hungry, they have desire for sex, they reproduce, they, you know, live their normal life and then they die at the end of life. This is their normal process of life. But human being has a very special faculty which has been endowed to us. And that enables us to think, what is this universe? And that is why this question comes, what is this universe? Who made it? No other species on this planet can think about that. And that is why the human life is supposed to be the most privileged life. In this life, we can understand the mysteries of this universe. And that is why in the Indian, ancient Indian writings, they always say that if you have got a human birth, please use it properly, do not waste this birth. This is a very rare birth. And they say you have to pass through all the 8.4 million species of life, different births, and then you come to this birth. And once you have come into this birth, continue to progress and rise. That is why this question we are asking today, what is the purpose of life? It is because we have a faculty in human mind, in human brain, which enables us to think about this. No other species of life can ask this question. They are just created, they live a normal life and then they die. They don't have this faculty to ask this question. So we are in that sense all privileged people, and we can think over these issues. What is this universe? Who made this universe? Who runs this universe? Who am I? Why I have come into this world? What is the purpose of my life? So that is the background of our talk. The background of talk is that we are privileged people. We are privileged species of life, which can think about this question, which can contemplate about this question, which can investigate it into this question, and we can try to find an answer to this question. Now, the second thing is there a purpose of life? Is there a purpose? Should there be a purpose? We are born here. Did somebody ask you whether you want to be born? Or we just appeared on this earth? I don't think anybody asked us whether you want to be born. We just appeared on this earth. When you feel hungry, does it happen on its own, or you do something to feel yourself hungry? It just happens on its own. You feel hungry. You feel, you know, desire to eat something. You feel thirsty. It happens on its own. Your birth happened on its own. Once you eat your food, do you do anything to digest that? Or it happens on its own? It happens on its own. The system inside keeps working, you do nothing to do it. So since all these things, we are breathing in and out on its own. The sun is rising and setting on its own. The earth is rotating and revolving on its own. Then why are we asking this question, should we have a purpose of life? We have been dispatched into this theater to perform something, and that is happening on its own. It's unfolding automatically. Then why do we ask this question? Is there a purpose of life? Or is there really a purpose of life? That is the question. Do we have a choice to choose our purpose? Can we really have a choice? Like we choose our spouse, do we really choose our spouse? That's the question we will deal with. I'll come to that question slightly later. You choose your spouse, you say, I chose my spouse. But do you really choose? That's the question. You produce a child. Do you really produce that child? Is it, it's happening, or do you really produce it? It's a question that we will ask. I'll come to that question a little later. Since we have just been pushed into this world, we have been not asked whether we should be born or not born, where we should be born, who should be our parents, what language should I speak, what kind of food I should eat. All this is decided by the accident of your birth, if it is an accident. You are pushed here and you are born and you are in this, what we call Mahasagar. You have to just swim, learn to swim, how to move and cross this Mahasagar. That is how the life actually moves. So then why are we asking the purpose of life? If we have been thrown into this vast ocean, we just swim and go wherever we need to go. So this is another question. Do we really have a purpose of life? And what is the purpose of asking this purpose? What is the purpose of asking this purpose? Why do we ask this question? Why this question comes to our mind? That is a very fundamental issue. We will deal with this in a few minutes. Now, based on this thinking that we have just been thrown into this world, we did not decide whether we should be born, where we should be born, and what should be our nationality, what should be our language, who should be our parents. Since we have been thrown into this world, why to bother? Don't bother. Let the philosophy like Charvak, who said, eat, drink and be merry. Live wherever you are, live happily. Forget about this purpose of life. Forget about why you are, why you have come into this world. Who has sent you? Forget about all that. That is one philosophy. That philosophy is not only in India, but this philosophy is also in the West. That don't think about all this. Be happy, live wherever you are, enjoy your life. Now, that is also in some way you can call it a purpose. Okay, that's also a purpose. In the what you call extreme sense, you can define it as purpose of life. But this is one way of thinking about the human life. That don't think about purpose, just live and enjoy. Now, some of these people, they go beyond this thinking, and some the second thought on this issue is that engage yourself into this world. Don't even have time to think about all this. Just engage yourself. Like you come to a theater and you play your role. There's somebody is playing, for example, Krishna Leela, and somebody is playing the role of Arjun there. Now you just play the role of Arjun. Don't think who created this play, why this play has been made, what is the purpose of this play. You just do your role. Your role is defined as Arjun. You would continue to do that, what has happened, what you are supposed to do. So that is another way of looking at it. The first one is somewhat different than this. Here, the purpose is that you have come to this theater to perform a role. You continue to perform that role. That role is what? That role is that you have to earn your livelihood, you have, you know, you get married, you live your married life, you have your children, you look after your children, and you earn, you know, if you want to earn some wealth, some status in the society, you remain engaged with that, continue to perform those activities and live. Don't think about anything beyond that. So that is another approach to life. And some people say that unless you throw yourself deeply into the world and get frustrated, you will never think about the purpose of life. Or even if you think, it will not be what we call a ripe thinking. The ripe thinking will come only when you throw yourself deeply into the world and when you get frustrated. For example, look at Tulsidas. Tulsidas was deeply in love with his wife, and he was so sexually strong that there's a story behind it that when his wife once went to his her mother's house, and he was so, you know, deeply driven by sexual desire that he went in the middle of the night. It was raining heavily. He had to cross a river, and in order to cross the river, there was a dead body floating. He just didn't realize what is this. He thought it was a kind of wooden piece. He just sat down on that dead body and crossed the river and went on the other side. And then there was a snake on the house where he was supposed to go, and he, you know, used that snake as a rope and climbed up the house. Now that is a story which is actually, I believe, is a true story about Tulsidas. And then his wife told him that time that if you have used so much devotion to come and see me, if you had used even part of it, you would have reached the Almighty. आपको राम मिल गया होता अगर आप इसका एक अंश मात्र भी आपने उधर किया होता. And then he was transformed completely. And then he left all the entire worldly thing and he went in a totally different direction, and he was with Ram all the time. Even otherwise, if you look in our normal world today, look at Bill Gates. He became one of the richest person in the world, but now he is fed up with the riches. He doesn't want to be rich. He is giving it away now. Look, any rich person who becomes very rich, at the end of his life, he gets frustrated with that riches and he wants to give it away. That is a sort of prayaschit. That is, we can call it daan, but it is also a prayaschit. Okay, now I give it back to the society. So the purpose of saying all this is that, is there a real purpose of thinking why I have come into this world? What is the purpose of life? And how that purpose can be achieved. Now, connected to that, I will deal with two issues today. One is that why, despite all the engagement in this world, we do have this desire from time to time that why I have come to this world. Why this question arises in your mind, in my mind, in everybody's mind. Because there is a reason for that. There is an innate reason. The innate reason is that basically the human being is part of what we call Satchitanand. Sat, Chit and Anand. That is, we will prove it later on, but for the time being you presume that we are part of that. And because of that Sat, Chit and Anand. Sat means the eternity, which does not depreciate with time, which is all the time eternal. Chit means which is consciousness. And Anand means bliss, total bliss. And therefore we are looking for the total bliss and eternity in the world somehow, somewhere, which is not available to us in what we call the material world. The wealth we acquire, the prestige we acquire, the children we acquire, they help you, they give you pleasure for a while, and then it turns into distress after a little while. So we get into a cycle of pleasure and distress, which continues. And therefore we look for what we call the eternal bliss. We look for eternal peace. We look for undisturbed peace. This is our innate desire because we have come from that. We are a part of that. It's like a drop from the ocean has all the qualities of that ocean. You can analyze the water of that drop. It will give you all those qualities which are there in the ocean water. Similarly, the Atma which we have inherited, which we have taken, is part of that Paramatma. And it has all those qualities which Paramatma has. And these are the, of course, there are many, but these are three principal qualities of the what we call Paramatma or universal consciousness. Sat, Chit, Anand. And since we are part of it, we have this innate desire to acquire that, to acquire Sat, Chit, and Anand, all the three. Now, let me give you an example to explain this. You have air in a tire or in a balloon. Now, the air in the balloon wants to get free and become part of the air which is there all around. So it keeps trying that, but it doesn't succeed. But as soon as it gets a chance, it breaks that balloon and merges with the air all around. That is how it happens. As soon as it gets a chance, it merges. Look at the water. Wherever the water is, wherever, it tries to go to the ocean. Whether it is in a pond or in a well, or whether it is in a river or on the mountain, it slowly, slowly flows and flows and flows and tries to go to the ocean. It's an inherent tendency to go to the ocean. Look at the earth, the particles of earth, sand. There's a huge wind and cyclone and, you know, all this. And the earth is blown all over in the atmosphere. But ultimately that air, earth wants to come back to the earth. It slowly, slowly comes down and falls on the earth. It wants to merge. You put a, for example, variety of animals together. Like I lived in Mongolia, which is in some ways partly nomadic country. Seen it. Now you have a variety of animals. You put cows and you put buffaloes and you put horses and you put yaks and you put say other forms of animals together. Ultimately, they will divide themselves into their own flock. The horses will go together with horses. The sheep will go together with sheep. The cows will go together with the cows. The, you know, other animals will go together with their own family. This is a natural tendency in this entire universe, that we want to become part of our own tribe. And therefore, this is the innate reason why we human beings are looking for purpose of life, looking for eternal bliss, looking for undisturbed peace, because we have come from Sat Chit Anand and we want to go back to Sat Chit Anand. But this I will not deal completely now. I'll take it at the end, maybe in the next session. But I wanted to give this idea that why this thought comes to our mind. This thought comes to our mind because this is a law of nature. This is an innate law that every species of anything wants to become part of that species. Even within the human beings, a smoker will find a company of another smoker immediately. You put together them, they will always find their company. A drunkard will find a drunkard in a crowd of 2,000 people. There's a way to find it. A doctor will find another doctor immediately. An engineer will find another engineer. This is an association of the tribe. And that is what is our association with Sat Chit Anand. So we leave this here for the time being. We go to another issue. We'll come back to this later on. Now, the third issue is very, very important issue is when we come into this world and we think about the purpose of human life. When we think about purpose of human life, it means that we should have free will to achieve that purpose. When you think about marrying a particular person, it means you have a free will to decide whether you can marry that person or not. When you go to a store and you want to buy a piece of, for example, trouser or a shirt, now you have a free will to decide that what trouser, what piece of shirt you want to buy. You have a free will, you can decide, isn't it? Is it a really free will? That is the question we will have to ask. What is the meaning of free will? Now, this in the Western philosophy, this question of free will is debated and debated and debated. Volumes have been written about this question. What is free will? Do humans have free will? If we are looking for purpose of life, it means we should have free will, and therefore we should be able to proceed towards that purpose based on our own decisions. But do we have that? So let us analyze this aspect a little bit. Now, there are many theories in the Western world about the free will. Free will basically means that you have variety of options and you have you can choose whatever you like there. That is the meaning of free will. You have 20 t-shirts lying in a shop, you can choose whatever t-shirt you like, that is your free will. Now, you get credit and you get discredit based on your free will. If you do something on your free will, then you should also be ready to take the blame and the credit for whatever decision you take. That is a very consequential issue which comes after the free will. But now let us go slightly deeper. Do we really have a free will? For example, now in northern India, there is a what we call winter season. Now, do you have a free will to put on the clothes you want to put on? Or you have to follow the law of the nature? Since it is winter, you have to wear woolen clothes. Can you wear t-shirt and go out? Does your free will work here? Can you go out in a shirt? No. You are conditioned by certain things. Now you go to the market and you want to buy a dhoti and you want to put on a dhoti. Do you have a free will to put on a dhoti? You will think that, oh, my friends will say, what has happened to you? Why are you wearing this? They will laugh at me. And my father wore that dhoti very regularly. If he wears trousers, people will say, what has happened to him? What is he doing? So do you really have a free will to put on your clothes? There are social constraints. There are social taboos. There are social norms which have been, which condition us to put on even the clothes which, even there we do not have a free will. Look at the food you eat. Do you have a free will to eat whatever you feel like? No, you don't. Firstly, you see what is available. Availability is decided by the existence, by the universe. What vegetables are available today? It is decided by what you call seasons and by the entire functioning of the nature. The nature decides on those issues, that what will be produced in this particular month. We don't decide. If you want to have a crop of, say, matira and tarbuj in this month, can you have it? You cannot have it. There's no free will there. The free will has many constraints. We have to work with a lot of constraints. When you go on the road, driving on the road, do you have the free will? There are rules which are regulating the traffic on the road. A policeman which will fine you. Yeah? There are laws which can make you, pay for violation of traffic. You live in a society somewhere. Like I live in an apartment complex. There are rules of community behavior. You have to follow those rules. You don't have free will. So there are two issues of the free will. The free will technically exists. You can say that I have freedom to decide whatever I like. But if you go deeper into that, you will find there are tremendous constraints which do not allow you the free will. The first constraint is the nature itself. The nature decides what you will eat, what you will wear, what time you will get up. Do you have the free will to get up? You get up with the sunrise. The sun rises and then you get up. You sleep with the sunset. And those people who violate this regularly, they fall sick. They have tremendous mental issues, other health problems. So the nature is one big, large, what you call determining force, which contains our free will. We lose our free will because of variety of laws of the nature which are in place. Look at the law of gravity, for example. You want to fly freely in the sky. Can you fly? The law of gravity will not allow you to fly. You want to see beyond all horizons. Can you see? There's a limitation of your eyes which will not allow you to see beyond a point. So there are innumerable constraints in our life, innumerable, which do not allow us the so-called free will. The first major group of constraints is decided by the nature itself, by the natural forces, whether they are forces of wind, the forces of rain, forces like sun or the moon, or the fertility of the soil, or and the seasons which are changing, the crops which are coming up. That is one big large group which decides on that. The second question is, the society in which we live, they put tremendous constraints on you. And you have to behave. In Sanskrit, there are two words, jagat and jagati. Jagat means, gat means gati. And jagat means a joint gati, a collective movement of the society. That is called jagat. So the collective movement of the society puts tremendous restrictions on your free will. Like in today's world, you want to, for example, don't have a mobile phone with you. Now your life will become extremely difficult because the movement, collective movement of the society has moved in that direction that you must have a cell phone. It has become like this. Now today people go by motor car to office. You want to use a horse and go to the office, people will laugh at you because this is the collective movement has changed of the society. There was a time when people used to use horses to go to the office or to the fields. But today if you do that, people will laugh at you because the collective movement of the society has taken a totally different direction. So the collective movement of the society is another constraint, a large constraint on your free will. The nature is one constraint, collective movement of the society is another constraint. Now the third constraint is a very big constraint again. A child who is born, he should have free will, he did nothing before his birth. Why is there a difference between the two children? One is born in a palace, another is born on the roadside. What did he do? He didn't exercise his free will. Why is there a distinction, such a vast distinction between the two? Somebody is born in India, somebody is born in USA, somebody is born in Antarctica, somebody is born in tropics in Africa. Somebody is born as black, somebody is born as white, somebody is born as brown. Somebody is intellectual, somebody is duffer. Why? They did nothing. The birth is the beginning of the life. so far as we are concerned. So where is the free will? He didn't exercise any free will. Why is he suffering those consequences or enjoying those fruits? What is that? So the third biggest determinant of free will is the accumulated karma of the past lives. But we call them as sanskar. Those sanskars is a baggage. It's like when we carry our baggage when we go on travel. Similarly, we come here on a journey to this world and we come with that baggage. That baggage is the accumulated balance sheet of the past karma. When you start a new year in a business, you prepare a balance sheet that these are my assets and these are my liabilities. Exactly the same way in this birth, when we come here, we come with a balance sheet which has certain assets and certain liabilities. And our birth is decided based on that balance. And that is why somebody is born as pauper and somebody is born as prince. Somebody is born as very sick, somebody is born very healthy. Somebody is born as white and somebody is born as black. And somebody is born as an animal and somebody is born as a human being. This is the baggage of the karma which we bring. We will talk about this little more in the next session, but what I wanted to emphasize today, in the context of the free will, there is no free will. The free will is in theory. We can claim that you have free will to act, and therefore I can decide on the mission of my life. But that is not true. If you go deep down into the entire process, you will find that the action you are performing in the present moment is the outcome of innumerable actions which have taken place in the past. There is a cause behind the action which you are taking now, and that cause lies in the past, and the past is a cumulative result of millions and billions of actions which have taken place, which are giving this result at the present moment. So this is how the free will is actually not a free will. It's just in theory we can call it free will. The three major constraints on the free will, first is the nature itself, the physical nature surrounding us. Whether it is the movement of the sun day and night, the movement of the moon, whether it is the wind directions and the seasons and the fruits and vegetables. And you want to eat something new, for example. You cannot eat anything new because the seed of the things which exist, only those things can be produced. You can produce mango and guava and you can produce banana. But if you think of some totally new fruit which never exists anywhere else, where is the seed? Where will you get it? The seed is a constraint. You cannot create a seed. The seed has been created. And you have to just use that seed to make your fruit or your vegetable or your crop, whatever it is. So where is your free will? So nature is one big constraint which regulates life, which decides on the choices you can adopt in your life. That is the first constraint. The second constraint is created by the society in which we live. The society decides on the collective movement of life. That collective movement creates hassles or hurdles in your way to go freely, to choose freely. That is not, for example, even the institution of marriage is part of the collective movement of the society. It has been decided. You have different religions with different norms and systems on that. But there is a system. We have traffic rules, we have constitution of a country, we have criminal laws, we have civil laws, and all these are a construct which has been done by the society in the march of its collective movement. And that is a huge constraint on our free will. Third constraint on our free will is the past events which have happened. Past events of our personal life, past events of this whole existence. Even the birth of this earth is the result of past events. Even the birth of sun and moon is the result of the past event. So the past events become the cause and in which the current event happens. The current event happens because of the cumulative result of the past events. So if this is what we call, it is called consequence argument in free will. There's an argument called consequence argument that everything is the consequence of something which happened in the past. That is how it is. Or which is constrained by the nature surrounding us. So there is no fundamental free will in that sense. Some people call it causal determination, that there's a cause, that is why this has been happening now. In this case, if we use the Indian word, this is free will is the Western approach. If we use the Indian word, then we can call it niyati, or we can call it bhagya. That ye to aapka bhagya tha, isliye aisa ho gaya. Now, this is a big question. If it is bhagya is to be decided everything, then why are we thinking about the mission of life? What is the objective of life? It will happen as per your bhagya, whatever happens, happens. Forget about it. Why are we, everything is determined here. Then why are we debating this issue? Why are we wasting our time on this issue at all? So these are the foundation of this whole question. Mission of life. What is the fundamental mission of life? So today I will conclude at this point, and from here we will move forward to a more intense debate in the next session on this entire issue. But let me repeat a few things today, just to recapture our thoughts of today. First of all, when we see around this whole universe, we see the wonders of this universe. We always think, who created it? If somebody created it, who created that creator? How the life originated on this earth? And how various species of life came into being with totally different structure, different way of life, totally different style, different life, in all. For example, the life of an ant is so different than that of an elephant. Or life of a cow is so different than that of a tiger, for example. So this has happened. But in this whole process, human being has been endowed with a faculty, human being alone, which enables us to think about this universe. What is this universe? Who created it? Why I have come into this universe? What is the purpose of my life? It is only the human being which can think about this question. No other species of life can think. And therefore, we are a privileged class in that sense. So this is one very big issue. We should use this privilege to understand this issue. That is the first thing. The second thing is, do we really have to think about the purpose of life? Do we have to? We talked about if we can live whatever way we were never asked whether we should be born, and we are breathing in and out without our knowledge, without our permission. The food is digesting, we feel hungry, we feel thirsty, we feel sleepy, we do nothing about all this. We feel sexual desire, the children are born out of that desire, and the life progresses, you reproduce yourself. This is all happening automatically. So why do we have to think about the purpose of life? Do we really have to think? That's the question. Things are happening automatically. Let them happen. And that is why there's a philosophy like Charvak who says that don't worry about all these things. Eat, drink, and be merry. That is one approach. This is how. And then we discussed about the question of free will. If everything is whatever we think we can do, then do we really have that freedom? Or it is all determined by the forces surrounding us? And we examined all the three things. We examined the nature, how it controls our life. We examined the society or the jagat, the movement of the society which controls our life. And the action which is happening now is actually the result of innumerable actions in the past. And the present event is the outcome of that. If you look at Mahabharata, it gives you a great, thinking. It makes you think a lot. The birth of Bhishma, which happened almost 150 years before the birth of Abhimanyu, that even that birth was the cause of Mahabharata. Even before that, they say why he was born, even that could be the cause of Mahabharata. So you don't know how the collective movement has been going on. How a particular nation has come into being today, it is decided by events which go back hundreds and thousands of years in time. Why there is a Great Britain today, English nation, a British nation today? Why there is a French nation? The cause goes back in time, the language came, how the language came, how the people came. It goes back thousands and thousands of years in time. So everything which happens today is a result of events that happened in multiple ways in the past. So we, in that sense, though it appears that human being has free will to choose, we can choose whichever political party we want to join, we can choose whom we want to marry, we can choose whatever clothing we want to wear, we can choose our food, we can choose our housing. It appears that we have free will. But if you go slightly deeper into this process, you will realize that you don't really have free will. All this has happened because of certain events which are governing your life for the last years and years and years. So this is what we call causal approach, or we call it consequence of the past. The free will does not exist in reality. It is only a result of the events in the past. So I will stop here today. And this is an introduction to this whole issue of purpose of life. And in the next talk, we will go into an intense debate about the purpose of life. So thank you very much.